Hello, Rob as a podcast community listeners. If you are just joining us, you are about to take a ride down one of the three rivers that connects in downtown Fort Wayne. Join Aaron and Matt as they go down what will surely be a very interesting journey. We don't know where it's going to go. We don't even know how it started, but you will sure laugh, cry, enjoy. And that's
how
I would open it. Yeah. You can even use that if you want to. I don't even.
Oh, I have to actually. Oh my God. Hello, everyone. It's Matt Scott, host of Pod Friends, and welcome to the show. The theme song you just heard was by the incredible Will from America. Shout out to Will, as always. And obviously, this episode started out a little bit differently. You heard from this week's guest, Aaron Robertson, summing up what to expect. And, you know, one thing I want to say is that as this Pod Friends journey continues, I, number one, find myself, honestly, if I'm just being real with all of you, like settling in more and getting more comfortable and finding my footing. Like one thing that each of my interviewees can attest to that sometimes makes it into the interviews is just that sometimes there are nerves going into it. Like, I don't know what to expect. I don't know how to start. I don't know what to start out by asking because there's so many directions we could go. This interview with Aaron is a great example of all of the places that we go and we can go in these Pod Friends conversations. Except I think you'll hear me like laughing and like having more of a good time and like interjecting because I'm just starting to settle in more and more and more into this. And I've had fun and I've loved the interviewees that I've invited on so far. But this is one, actually, this is the latest one that I recorded. And it was one where I kind of just said, let go. Like, let me just let go and follow wherever this is going. I don't know where this is going, but really just had a conversation. And that was what was really nice. So I'm thankful that you could be here. I'm thankful that you could be my associates, my confidants, my besties, my companions, my teammates, my tag team partners, my running buddies, my walking partners, my squadettes, my pod friends on this journey, and that I could share that with you and share this conversation with Aaron, where we went all over the place, but we talked about his life growing up. We talked about how he's moved around so much and even how that contrasts with a lot of my experiences being more in the same place and how that's affected how he lives and who he is and how he sees the world. We talked about his life in Fort Wayne, Indiana, where he lives now, and a little bit about growing up. We talked about his passion for theater and the arts and how he turned that into a career, his love for reality TV. And we took some time just to kind of fanboy together, really, about a lot of 2000s reality shows, including the show Endurance, which we both loved, which we bonded over the fact that, like, a lot of us, the two of us and a lot of us in this community, like, didn't have those outlets to have conversations with people about these shows in the 2000s, before social media was what it was, before RHAP was what it was. We were just finding our place. And so we also talked a bit about games, about chaotic good and the other archetypes that are within Dungeons and Dragons, D&D, we talked about how Aaron's different and how he looks at the world differently. And there was really a heartfelt moment later on where Aaron kind of sends a message directly to Rob in particular, Rob Sesternino, creator of Rob Has a Podcast. And, you know, one thing that's so interesting about Aaron is while I became a podcaster with RHAP in 2020, Aaron actually started with the network in 2012. And so he's been around for a long time. And I'll be honest, that moment like made me tear up and got me a little choked up. And so if there's anything I want to say that I kind of hope that you take away from this episode, it's just this idea of letting go and having fun and being loose and like throwing the script out, because you never know what'll happen when you do that. But before we dive in, I actually, you know, one of the things that Aaron and I talked about again was games. I've watched him play Mafia before on Zoom. I've watched him play Black Widow Brigade, which was this survivor-based online reality game created by Alex Gardner, who is a Philadelphia-based creator and a member of this community. Someone who, like Aaron, also submitted a ton of Wand Off songs to Josh Wiggler's Wand Off, and Casey Kasem's Wand Off series, if you're familiar with that. And I wanted to acknowledge that because I want to share something really special with all of you that is just dropping today. And, you know, some of you might know this, but I was part of this live reality game called Survivor Philadelphia. And the trailer just dropped today. It's out now. I want you to check it out. And the theme of Survivor Philadelphia, this insanely well-produced live reality game. Like, this wasn't just one camera. It wasn't just someone's shaky phone. There were like 10 cameras filming and music, soundtrack, all of it. It will feel like Survivor in this Survivor off season. And if you are a Survivor fan, I can't encourage you to check it out enough. The theme is head versus heart. So Survivor Philadelphia head versus heart season 2 is going to be a thrilling one. And it actually will drop Tuesday, July 19th at 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Central. Only on the Survivor Philadelphia YouTube channel. So you can subscribe on YouTube. And if there's one place I want to point you, it's to that YouTube channel. So you know me, if you know me, if you've listened to Pod Friends, you know I love my short links. So you could go to bit.ly/survivorhvh. That's bit.ly/survivorhvh. And that is where you can go to the YouTube, subscribe, and make sure that you do not miss it, because this is going to be a lot of fun. And a little bit more about Survivor Philly, you could follow on Instagram at Survivor Philly. You could follow on Facebook, on Twitter for updates, and meet the cast player profiles. So I'll be in there. Other people will be in there. Some you might recognize, others who you don't, which I think is the fun of these games. And you could watch weekly once the show drops July 19th on Tuesdays at 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Central. So I just want to say, regardless of how I did, I'm just thankful I could be part of the series. And I want to spread the word and send love and point as many of you, whether you're Survivor fans or not, or just listeners here and part of this community, check it out. And again, it's created by Alex Gardner, who is creator of season 1 of Survivor Philadelphia, of course, featuring Bryce Isaiah of Survivor Cagayan and the Purple Pants podcast, Wendell Holland of Survivor Ghost Island and Winners at War. So we have some real survivors out there, as well as community members you may know, like Dr. Amanda Rabinowitz, it's Dan Sinensky, Jason Curtis Rivera, and more. Black Widow Brigade, the survivor-based game where you might have seen Mike Bloom and Josh Wiggler and Shannon Gus and DJ LaBelle Klein and Karen from Canada, and Jess Sterling, and Will, and Ali Lasher, and Lexi from Survivor Philly 1, and Karishma, and Lirsa from Survivor. And so it's going to be an exciting one, I am sure, and I'm excited to watch along with all of you. But before diving into the interview with Aaron, I just want to plug, number one, check out the show notes for links to a bunch of things, links to Survivor Philly, links to the Pod Friends feed where you could subscribe, robhiswebsite.com/podfriendsfeed. If you're not already subscribed, please leave a 5 stars, leave a review, and I will dive back into those and at some point share some of those on this podcast. Watch on YouTube. You could see me, you could see Aaron, you could see all these Pod Friends episodes on YouTube at robhiswebsite.com/YouTube. You could suggest a guest going to bit.ly/podfriendsnom. That's bit.ly/podfriendsnom. Today is the start of the month, and it's a perfect time to become an RHAP, Rob Has a Podcast Network patron. So you can go to robhiswebsite.com/Patreon. Check out some of the different patron benefits. There are so, so many. There are exclusive podcasts on Patreon, which I love to tune into. I love to be part of. There are lots of great opportunities to connect with the community, to connect with Rob, to connect with all of us podcasters, all of us Pod Friends. And I think if there's anything that's really special about being an RHP patron, it is the community and that opportunity to really like get to know people and bond with people. And, you know, in a lot of ways, kind of like Aaron and I talk about in this interview, have your life changed in many ways. And so check out the show notes for more and follow Pod Friends on social media at Hey Pod Friends. Follow me on social media at Matt Scott GW. That was a lot of plugs before diving in, but I wanted to get to those before going into this very, very, very fun interview with Aaron Robertson. So let's get started. Making his way to the podcast, hailing from Fort Wayne, Indiana, by way of Buffalo, New York, and many stops in between, from joining Rob Has a Podcast in 2012 with the Friggin' Five, all the way to covering shows like Survivor, Pirate Master, and Endurance. With his synesthesia and perfect pitch, he's seeing the world in vibrant colors, marching to the syncopated beat of his own drum, and creating audio magic that's music to your ears, from wand-offs with Jordan Kalish to planting seeds, baby, as a junior by Bible quiz champion, a lover of theater and the arts, and a reality TV superfan, please welcome the one, the only, Aaron Robertson. I want to start out by apologizing to you.
To me? Why?
Yeah. Well, so I went back and I was listening to the Black Voices of RHAP podcast.
Yes.
And I was like, okay, like, what was our conversation? Aaron, of course, you were part of that, the first panel, the present panel in the Black Voices of RHP podcast about reality TV representation. Yeah. And, you know, I had these, like, grand intros for each person. And I am like, Matt, what were you thinking? Because I basically called you old in that. Like, here's the most senior member this podcast. He's been doing this since you were probably in diapers. I didn't say all that, but...
yeah.
That was the gist of it. And I'm like, oh. Matt, you've grown over the years. You don't call people senior anymore. Well, so it's been a year, but I wanted to apologize for that. It's been on my heart.
You are absolutely fine. You know, it's weird, knowing that I've been involved with this podcast over the last 11 years. Mm-hmm. That's been weird to think about.
Yeah.
But I'm excited to have done everything I have. I'm excited to do more for this podcast, you know, and contribute more than now that I have the time to do so.
Yeah.
I'm very excited.
Yeah. It's interesting because, you know, this is, I don't know, I'm thrilled to dive in. Like, we have never podcasted one-on-one.
No.
Or in, like, a small group, in, like, a more intimate setting. So yeah. This is great. And, you know, something that, one reason I really wanted to interview you is because, number one, I just feel like your energy is always there. And not only in the podcast, it's always... there's an aura. You do have an aura to you. I'm going to stop complimenting you. I have to stop.
God.
This is too much for the people. But Yeah, it's kind of like, yeah, you have, but you have that and you bring that. And I think that a lot of, you know, especially people who've been on this network for mm-hmm. a while, probably yeah. like develop and grow into that, but you have that. And also because I feel like I've watched you play like a weird amount of game, like between Mafia and Black Widow Brigade, Alex Gardner's game and all that. I've watched you play a random amount of games where I'm like, what's Aaron doing and what is he thinking, basically?
Yeah, yeah. And that, you know, that's, yeah, I'm surprised. I'm not surprised that I've come off that way. I definitely have that energy when it comes to games where people watch and go, what is Aaron doing? But yeah. I think it's all in the fun that I bring. I am what we say in D&D, I would say I am chaotic good.
Ooh, better than chaotic bad. I only learned what that meant like 3 months ago, so I feel really cool now. But yes,
yeah.
I think it's also pretty straightforward probably what chaotic good is, and is it chaotic evil as the other side of things?
So there's good, neutral, evil, and then chaotic, uh-huh. neutral, and lawful.
Oh,
so yeah,
what is chaotic lawful?
So chaotic lawful is, well, the lawful side of people do things according to the rule. Mm-hmm. Wait, hold on.
That makes sense.
Hold on. Not chaotic lawful. Okay, so there's chaotic.
Look, myself. I'm on the journey. You convinced me of anything.
Yeah.
Look, I'm with it. I'm with you.
Okay, so in D&D, there yes. is... like, for example, with chaotic, there's chaotic good, chaotic neutral, and chaotic evil. Or, mm-hmm. And then neutral good, neutral, and then neutral evil, and then yeah. the lawful side. So the more lawful someone is, the more they follow things by the rules. So a lawful good and a lawful evil person mm-hmm. will do things according to the rules, but they're... end goals are different.
Oh my gosh.
According to like how good or evil or neutral they are. So if somebody's lawful neutral,
yes,
then they would just kind of, you know, they'll follow the rules, but they'll just they don't really care, you know,
yeah.
they're not really tied to good or evil. They're just, you know, neutral. Look. Then in neutral people are just that's scary.
Okay, I this is the, yeah, 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 kind of like the vacant I imagine like vacant eyes type of mm-hmm. Deal there. Now I'm going to pull up a list of all of the podcasters, and you're going to categorize every single as evil,
oh my god,
good, chaotic or not. I don't know. I think like something that I'm kind of imagining as we just start having this conversation mm-hmm. is like, we're just sitting down, you know, I don't know. So you're in Indiana, you're in Fort Wayne, Indiana.
Yes. That's where I currently am.
Yes.
We could talk about my journey here alone. Like there's so much time that could be spent on that because, I'm also, I guess, technically a military brat.
Mm.
And I also technically moved around a lot. But it was not because my parents were active at the time, because they were in the reserves since I was born.
Yeah.
That definitely moving around definitely did shape my experience. And it definitely lended myself towards trying to escape reality in some way, whether that was through watching reality TV or immersing my head in stories of fantasy, fiction. And then later, as I got older, getting more into D&D and LARPing and doing all of that stuff in theater, of course. So, yeah.
Wow. So, yeah. It's interesting, though, because I want to dive into all of that and kind of your journey, and we will do that over time. Mm-hmm. But
yeah,
picture it where, you know, now we're not in the same room, but like if we were together in Fort Wayne, where yes. would we be? What would we be doing? I'm trying to set the scene and like picture it and feel it, you know?
Ooh, okay. So Fort Wayne, Indiana, mm-hmm. Is known as the city of three rivers, because there are three rivers that flow in the city and meet.
I really was like, what's he about to say?
I haven't lived here that long to really truly like understand the actual aura of stuff. I want to say they're tributaries that connect eventually to the Mississippi River.
That sounds about right.
Because that sounds about right for this area. but there are three rivers that that meet in the middle in this town. And this town was formed around these three rivers. So it's been known as the City of Three Rivers ever since. And so downtown, there's been a lot of work on, I guess, for lack of a better word, gentrification that is happening, and, you know, rebuilding the waterfront and rebuilding the urban areas to look more modern and sleek and, you know, more affluent, if you will.
Right. We have that. That's constantly. I've been in D.C., like living here in Washington, D.C. for 12 years, and it's just been gentrification central the whole time. So I could relate.
You know, fun fact.
Oh.
I will be in D.C. in like 2 weeks.
What? Okay, wait. We'll do the logistics later. I'll be here.
Yeah, it's actually a big part of I guess, the end of my journey that we'll talk about is currently I work a job. I work as a data analyst, and I often will have to fly into D.C. because they're based in that area. So, I'll be in D.C. a lot more often.
Wow, look at that.
It'll be my second home, quote unquote.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Wait, back to Fort Wayne. We're going to
coming
back.
Yeah. In the same way that, you know, I play the games and people go, "What is Aaron doing?" This is probably, you know, a peek into my mind, the way that my mind tends to it connects everything together, but it does it in a very meandering way. In the same way that three rivers meet in the middle.
Wow.
Like the logic is there. It's just in a different way. It flows in a different way.
I picture us sitting on a bench. There's a bench. It's a park
there,
bench.
There's a park. Yeah, there's a park they just built downtown called Promenade Park.
Ooh.
And it's on the bank of one of the rivers. And there's like boats that go through there and like really nice park furniture. And like a place for a band to play, an event building for people to host events in the park if they want to. Very urban park.
Mm-hmm.
Everything you could see in an urban park, it would be there.
Ooh. Yeah.
But on a river.
I like this.
Yeah.
I like this. I picture there's the bench, there's the band in the distance, far off enough where you can't hear it, which is why you could hear us talking in this podcast. We're looking out at the three rivers and just taking it in. It's calm. It's beautiful. I mean, I should ask, how do you like living in Fort Wayne? How do you like Indiana overall?
Ooh.
I don't know how to feel about Indiana.
Personally. Yeah. And Indiana was always a weird place for me. Because my mom, she was adopted by a family in Buffalo, and they had moved back and forth between Buffalo and Richmond, Indiana. And mom did not like living in Richmond, Indiana. And, you know, just because it was a very small town, and she just wanted to get out and do something else.
Right.
But the things that we both appreciate about Indiana is that Indiana, the arts are huge here, I would say. I think they are just as much into the arts here as they are into sports.
Mm-hmm.
You know, It's often you would see a lot of marching bands out of Indiana competing, a lot of show choirs out of Indiana competing at various high schools and things, colleges, lots of different theaters around the place. And because Indiana is the crossroads of America, being in Fort Wayne is kind of advantageous because I'm about a couple of hours from the majority of major Midwestern cities. You know, Chicago is just as far from here as Cleveland is, or Columbus, or Cincinnati, or Louisville, or, you know, it's not like it's, you know, but within 2 to 4 hours at the most, really, from a lot of major Midwestern places. So if you did want to get out and do like a day trip somewhere, you could. If you wanted to stay in Indiana, you could. But, you know, Fort Wayne is the second largest city to Indianapolis, and it's a rather very large small town. It's very expansive, but it's also nowhere near the population of Indianapolis. So,
yeah. Is that the Midwest, technically? Would you consider yourself in the Midwest?
Technically, Indiana would be in the Midwest, yeah.
Okay. It is interesting. I feel like I don't have a lot of interactions with Midwesterners.
Yeah.
I was going to say Midwest people, but I feel like, you know, you are people. You are Midwest people. Yes.
Yeah. And it's weird because I've lived in almost every region of the U.S. at some point in my life, with the exception of the Pacific Northwest. I would say I have no idea what the area is like. But
well, like, what are the I mean, because I'm sure people ask you all the time, like, where have you lived? Do you have that on your mind? Like, do you have, like, the cities or the towns and the states? Like, just are you able to rattle those off?
Yeah.
What are they?
Yeah. I was born in Newport News, Virginia.
Okay.
Grew up in Hampton, Virginia for the first 9 years of my life. And then I moved to Buffalo. And moved different schools around there, lived in, eventually ended up in East Amherst or Williamsville, went to college in Columbus, Ohio, or Granville, Ohio, which is 40 minutes east of Columbus.
Okay.
Taught in Korea, came back.
Oh my gosh.
Lived in Columbus, Ohio proper and the surrounding areas for a bit while I was figuring life out, and ended up going again to school, this time in Phoenix, Arizona.
Wait, how old are you at this in Phoenix? I'm trying to keep up with like how quick these shifts are happening, because you mentioned school.
So I think it's pretty, so first 9 years of my life were in Virginia. Next 9 years of my life or so, not eight-ish years of myself, my life is in Buffalo and Williamsville and East Amherst. That's the western part of New York. Not New York City, New York State.
No, yes, New York State.
I'm for those you. Of you, you know, it's often people think New York and they just think the city, and no, it's a different part of the state. Western New York is where I lived. And then after those 8 years, I was 17, went to college in Ohio, near Columbus. And when I was 21, I moved to Korea and taught. So yeah, I turned, ended up turning 22 right before I moved to Korea. Was there for a year, came back to America, lived in Columbus for a bit. At the age of 23, I moved to Phoenix, Arizona for more school. Finished that when I turned 24, I ended up moving over to New York City, now New York City.
Okay, well, wait.
Living in New York City.
Follow along, people. New York City, we're back.
We're back in New York State. Now we're in New York City.
Yes, yes.
And then when I was in New York City, I ended up getting hired to work in Fort Wayne, Indiana. And I've been here ever since.
I was going to say, I know it's delayed, but congratulations. And then how long have you been in Fort Wayne now?
It will be 4 years in November.
Wow. You know, something that I was actually thinking about earlier today, just in relation to me being here living in DC, is like I grew up in New Jersey in the same town, the same house, like for the first 18 years of my life. And then I moved to DC for college, and DC is a very transient city. Like people are coming and going constantly. I have multiple friends, close friends, who have like obviously were here for college and then they left and they come back and they left and they came back, and like one who even like taught in Korea, for example. And so like, you know, all over the place. And I realized, I'm like, damn, I've been in DC for 12 years straight. And that's like, I was starting to think about what that says about me as a person, even in terms of just like being, maybe I've never really thought of myself as someone who's like, oh, I like what I like, and I like to be in a comfort zone, because so often I feel like I kind of have to, I mean, I'll say in so many ways, but especially just as like a young Black queer person, like there's so much that like forces me out of the comfort zone. but it's interesting. And I guess that leads to kind of what I'm curious with you, is like, how do you think that living in all of those places and moving around and experiencing these different things has affected you?
It really did affect me a lot. I think just thinking about it, in the last 10 years, I've lived in at least 7 different places. So, and before that, the longest I'd ever been in a school was maybe 2 years before my senior year of high school, and that was the third year. So college was the first time where I was really at a school for like a full 4 years, or like a full length of time. So it was constantly seeing new faces year after year in different environments and having to quickly adapt and adjust over time. And there wasn't really a constant. And I think part of me got complacent in that like, oh, you know, I'll be somewhere different. So if I mess up here, it'll all be over, you know? So I think it was very difficult for me to make friends, or what I would consider a friend to be. I think I saw a lot of people in my life growing up as acquaintances, people that I knew, people that I got along with, but people that I didn't necessarily consider close to me or friends, because I had only known them maybe a year or two at most. And like, you know, and as I get older, now people have been together for longer, especially if they all grew up in the same town, around the same people. So it was both more difficult to approach different groups and integrate myself into those, but also easier as people got older and, you know, it's a word that starts with a P, and that's like, it's like,
I don't know if it's like permanence. I don't know if it's process. Like, let me just start naming keywords.
It's not plastic.
Oh, the like plasticity?
No.
It's
like surface level.
I know that there are people who are
like screw the
yelling
P-word.
Like surface the P word. The P word. The P word. Which but yeah, surface.
And I'm gonna wait. I'm gonna
Like superficial, not superficial.
Yes, no. It was S. I'm sorry. It's not S. It's superficial.
Having too much fun right now.
Yes. So to go back, it was both harder because they were more established, but easier because a lot of the superficial stuff of being kids and like what we kind of judged each other or like separated from each other for, a lot of that triviality was gone. So it was just like, we're adults, you know, we could be friends. It doesn't have to be like this, like you can only hang out with the cool kids kind of thing. So it kind of really shaped who I was, because in academics, I felt like that was always where I had to prove myself, because I'm always coming in as the new kid, and social skills and socially being able to connect with people was just something that it was just really hard to do in person. I felt like I could really only communicate either in the arts or in academics. And by showcasing myself as a reliable academic person, I could be both the reliable son at home. I could also be the reliable peer to come to if people needed help studying or helping mentor them in really being able to be their best selves when it comes to academics. I love helping people. I love helping people study. I love tutoring of that kind of thing. And it was something I always really enjoyed. And math was my favorite subject growing up. Bless I loved you. Math so much. Numbers made sense to me. Those multiplication sheets, I was always excited the days that we got those, because I would finish that stuff so quick. I'd be the first one to hand in my sheet because I was so excited.
I'm tempted to ask you a math problem right now, but I wouldn't know the answer. So,
and you know, AP calculus was my favorite class I ever took in primary school prior to college, just because it was just so cool. And that translated itself well over to music, because being on top of rhythms and stuff,
yeah,
and getting that technicality and being able to communicate and be a pseudo leader in the arts was also very important to me, because I couldn't socially express myself with words. I never ate lunch in the cafeteria the older I got, because it was too hard for me to do it. I couldn't do it. I always had to go to the music wing and eat lunch there instead, because it was a place where I felt like I could express myself and be understood the most, mm-hmm. both by the teachers and by the peers that I had at the time. And I was always very sensitive to sound just from the second that I was born. So having synesthesia, you know, hearing music and colors and then having perfect pitch helped me to be a better composer and also be more proficient in terms of understanding what teachers were asking for in music and things and the like. Yeah.
One thing I'm so fascinated by, because there's a lot there.
Yeah.
Is did you find that you were like aware of these things about yourself in the real time, or has that awareness come just through reflection and through, you know, growing up and looking back?
I think growing up, I was always relatively self-reflective, but mm-hmm. it was only through the prism of what I understood at the time. So I was able to analyze myself. And as the older I got, the more deep and the more analytical and the more understanding of my past and present self has come more to light for me.
Yeah, because I have a theory here listening to you a little mm-hmm. bit that, and who knows, I feel like this is like the way that my mind works is like I make connections between like a lot of different random things, and maybe this is something that's like obvious to people and just not, you know, but mm-hmm. making this connection, which is just that I, you know, again, as someone who in contrast to you has often been in the same places, I feel like that maybe, you know, for better, probably for worse, but that breeds like this idea of like, I need to be perfect. I need to get this thing right. I need to like do this thing right. Like I don't have that reset and that restart, which like we all do. We're all really like, as I grow older, I realize we all have that ability to like change our lives and like dictate the direction that we're going in. But you know, I imagine the reason I bring that up is like on the flip side, you as someone who's kind of been in these different settings, you've had mm-hmm. this opportunity to start over. And so you could kind of like look back at the last thing and be like, okay, here's what I want to do different in this place. Or here's how I want to like because you've had starts so many times. Like every single time you move somewhere, it's like it's a fresh start. And it's like, it's almost like if you're playing a video game and like, you know, you're in level five or whatever. I don't know. Level five. That's like an old school video game. Like you're in level like 100, let's say, you know, you're deep in there and then like you, your character dies. And then you kind of start from the beginning or whatever, or the last save point. And it's like, okay, I'm learning from that. Now here's how I'm gonna like show up differently. Did you have any like exciting or wild new starts? And also like, let me know if that assessment of you was completely off. But I am curious if there were like any times where you're like, this is it. This is gonna be the time that I'm doing it. I'm changing everything. I don't know what you.
I think the biggest change where I was able to bring my best self forward, and I was really excited about the direction that things were going at the time, was when I moved to Phoenix for audio engineering school. It was after I came back to America, and I was trying to figure out. I love the performing arts. I love music. I love theater. I've been doing them all of my life. Those have been my constants other than reality TV. But I also know that realistically right now that, you know, if I want to be able to pay my bills and be able to do the arts down the road, that I can't just go in and try to be the face. I can't be like the actor. I can't be the musician on stage, because not all of those paths, if I go down that career road, would necessarily lead to being stable financially. And so I thought, okay, I think things are going to go digital. This is back in like 2016. So I'm thinking, things are going to be more computer-based the later in years we go, at least right now. So what's a good way that I could combine music and theater and technology together? And that's when I came upon audio engineering. And it's such a vast field that covers a lot of different areas. So there's places like music production, the people that work on records for different artists and labels and things. There's post-production, the people that are working on the sound and the music for video games, for movies, for film. There's live sound, people who are doing concerts. If you want to get more niche, you can get into theatrical sound. The people that are either controlling the sound for shows on Broadway and regional productions, or even the people that are designing the sound that are is going to be used in the shows. You know, VR sound creation. I mean, the list kind of goes on from there, and each category has a lot of different subcategories. But I thought it would be a good place to start and really get to know different areas of the industry and see which one I wanted to go down. And I liked this school because it was designed to where you would go to the school for the better part of a year, and then the last portion of your education was actually an internship, where you would pick a city, you would move there, you'd land an internship, do that internship for a few months. And the idea would be that they want to put you in the best position to be hired either by that place or get enough experience to get the ball rolling for other places. And I think I was my best self there because right from second one, I wanted to make sure that I stood out. And I felt like Rob playing Redemption Island. I felt like playing on New Game Plus. It was like I had all of this knowledge. And because I went in as a 23-year-old and not as like a 17-year-old, I was coming in with a bit more of a leadership role. And it was I really wanted to make a difference for everybody that was there while I was there. I made sure to always be available for the staff, always available for the students, ended up leading student organizations, helped clean up during winter breaks and things, getting to know the staff, getting to know the areas, really learning the craft day in, day out. I breathed that school. I didn't really socialize outside of it. And they give like out awards at the end. And I was able to get like a, you know how there's like gold, platinum records. I was able to get like diamonds.
Haven't won them, but
I what? Know. Yeah.
Diamonds.
Yeah. And I was able, I got this mic actually.
Oh my gosh. because is it made out of diamonds?
No, it's a baby bottle. It's a blue baby bottle for those of you who are listening. And I really love it. And I've treasured it ever since because it's represented all that hard work that I did during that school time. I really felt like I was going somewhere with that. And I think had I been in a different city, under different circumstances, I really do feel like this path really would have led me on, and it still can, but lead me on a really cool audio engineering path. And I was really excited about just the experience of being a mentor and hearing back from the people that were grateful for me to me for being able to mentor them and help foster a sense of community at the school and foster a sense of putting your effort, 100%, you get in what you put in, you get out what you put in. And I really wanted to make sure that everybody was able to be their best when they left.
Wow. I love this. And I think that, there's so much there and there's so much to your story, but I think, obviously I know that you are a wand off composer. You experience with that. But I have to say something that I realized, and this was talking with a few different people, is like, I listened because, right now there's not the wand off, but I listened to the wand off and I never would like keep track of who's doing what. So I remember the first time, actually about a year ago, that I sort of like started to talk with people in the community more and more, and get to know, not just podcasters, but like, fans and listeners and people who were really tapped in, like other wand off creators. They were like, "Oh, do you remember me from the wand off?" And I was like, "I don't remember what I had for breakfast this morning." So I will say, like, what were some of your greatest wand off hits that you're most proud of? And kind of like, obviously, for those that don't know, the wand off is like parody songs, basically.
Yeah.
Typically based on like you take like a popular song of some sort, not necessarily pop, but a popular song, and then there's the Survivor episode that week and you're making the song based on whatever happened. So like, what have some of your best hits been, and are they out there for the people to hear?
I think some of my best hits were pre-wind off.
Oh,
because before the wand off, because the wand off started during HHH and season 35.
Yeah.
And before that, back in 2014, when we were mere interns.
Oh my God.
Back in the days of interns, Jordan Kalish and I had made Jordan Kalish and I, and then Nick Fishman and I, we would always do a season song at the end of the season. So the first one that I ever did, and it was the biggest one that I still remember making it. It was like the day of the Cagayan finale. And Jordan and I had written and recorded "What Does the Llama Say?"
Based on "What Does the Fox Say?" Of course.
Yes. Which of was that huge. Same year, of that same like 2013, 2014, it was like during the Blood versus Water Cagayan season of airtime. And it was so cool seeing the response to it and everybody really enjoying it. And it was so fun making that song.
How did it go? Like, how did the song go?
Oh, goodness. Wow, I'm gonna have to remember this. Woo says woo. Cass goes something. Yeah, it's on YouTube. I think it's still on YouTube. If you look at what does the light have that back then, mm-hmm. And be like, because we were the only people doing that. And I collabed with different people each year. And I think I even did one with DJ LaBelle Klein. Wait, mm-hmm. Was it DJ LaBelle Klein?
Probably. No.
Yes. Why did I know who that was? Wait a minute.
Oh my gosh.
No, I don't think it was DJ LaBelle Klein.
Oh my God, you've been around so long doing so many collabs with so many people are you the insert artist here who does lots of collabs of are you the Nicki Minaj
wow,
I don't know,
maybe you might be. I don't know. You know, because it was just like we were just doing so many different things. I think it was the song I did for season 33. Well, and it was like a mix between millennials
versus Gen X.
Yes. Ryan Elder. Oh my God. Ryan Elder.
That's Ryan Elder.
Yes. Yes. Not yet. And I was so excited to do that collab with Ryan Elder and Jordan Kalish for the season 33 song, which I really enjoyed doing. I don't think I had a name for it.
Mm-hmm.
Get Figgy with it. I really loved Get Figgy with it. It was so fun. I love Get Figgy with it so much.
I love how even just the names are like enough to make you laugh, you know? Like,
yeah, and it was
one of the beautiful things about it.
I did a lot of ambitious things at the time for making different songs. Oh, you know what it was? I think it was because they started doing like the radio during that time, and they had like people like send in songs of the week of like, what's Casey Kasem, like what's on the radio, but like the wand off was not a thing at that time. So it was, it started off with me, Jordan Kalish, Nick Fishman doing end of season songs, then they started doing the radio stuff, then that turned into the wand off, and that was it was
wow. Oh my gosh, you were pre-wand off. You preceded, I know you were on the network before the wand off, but you paved the way for the wand off. What? Oh my gosh. What? I didn't know. Okay, wait.
I've been around the block. Okay.
Before we'll get back to talking about like your entry into RHAP and all of that, but I want to actually talk about your perfect pitch and synesthesia.
Yes.
One though, I don't know. I'm trying to trick you into singing or something like that. That's what I'm trying to secretly do, but I don't know. But let's just assume that I just tricked you into, is there something like, I really want to hear you sing. And I don't want to go on YouTube and do it. I'm just going to be honest. Is this just a thing? Do you have to like warm up or something?
No.
What a blast. I love it.
I mean, like if I wanted to really make sure that my voice was like generally okay, like I warm up, but I sing along to a lot of things.
Yeah.
You know, music that I'm listening to, harmonizing with it. And that's really fun. Is being able to know the harmonies and come in with them whenever, come up with your own intricate sounds and make the songs, you know, kind of add your own color to the songs you're listening to. Ooh. I've always wanted to upload things of me harmonizing with different songs to see what they sound like before and after, but I don't know.
We love that. Look, I know. I mean, maybe like kind of what it transitions into though is that I remember when we did the Black Voices of RHAP conversation, you know, you were talking about different shows that you loved. You were talking a lot about American Idol. We mentioned making the band, and I am still obsessed with Danity Kane. So don't at me. If you have a problem with Aubrey O'Day, take it up with Aubrey. With Dawn Richard, take it up with her. they're probably on good terms now. Who knows? Maybe they'll make another album at some point. Ooh. But, you know, this all like ties into reality TV. Did you find that as you were getting into reality TV, that it was like more music oriented? Like, what was your entry point into your love of reality TV? Because obviously that eventually helped lead you to RHAP, but like, what was it that, what was the spark of that? And
yeah,
kind of what was your path with it?
Yeah, I think, I mean, starting in 2000s, I mean, there was just reality TV
everywhere
in so many different places.
Out up and the wazoo, like, as people
used yeah, to and it was just like, you know, I mean, Survivor had been out, but I don't think I was really paying attention to it at the time since I was six. Mm-hmm. When it came out, and I don't think my family was really, we were more watching like the American Idols and things. And then I found Big Brother first, actually, before Survivor, because it was during the summer and we're not in school. So like, you know, it was Big Brother 5 was the first one I ever found. And it was hard to really keep up with that show at the time because we still had VCRs. And it was on different times, on different days of the week. And like, as a child, trying to program the VCR to do that, like, I didn't have the brain at the time for that.
You didn't have the calendar for that.
No, no. I think it really wasn't until 2005, I want to say, where I really started to... I missed Big Brother 6 this year, that year, in 2005. But I did find Survivor Guatemala, and that's where I, in the middle of it, and I kind of really stayed with that going forward. But before that, you know, I'm a kid at the time. I love watching different shows. And in the age of DVR and TiVo and stuff, there was always I just loved the channels that they had. There's so many channels. There's a channel for everything, and it was great. And some of my favorites were things like Nick Gass.
Ooh, yes.
Love Nick Gass.
That was awesome.
And it was really cool. You know, it just started games with game shows. It started games with game shows. Yeah, games and sports. Game shows. Guts.
Yeah.
Legends of the Hidden Temple.
Figure It Out was on there. Figure
It
Out.
It was so
Double
great.
Dare.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah. And Discovery Kids was big for me because it had shows like Endurance. Endurance was huge for me as a child. Huge. You know, hence
talk
why I
podcasted about it years later. Talk about that for a second, because I was such... I actually, at one point, I'll say attempted to submit an audition tape for Endurance when I was like 14. Fully did.
Yes.
But I did not tell my parents because I was like... I don't know if they'll let me do this. And I also don't like, it was the jankiest submission. JD Roth, who I think that's his name, the host.
Yes.
JD Roth. If he opened that, he was like, what is this mess that this child sent to me? So I think the show was shortly ended after that. But yeah, I tried.
It was weird because it was like, I remember watching it growing up on Discovery Kids and being like, I want to do that. And it was also around the same time I discovered Survivor. And, you know, Endurance Hawaii is still one of my favorite reality TV shows of all time. It was just, it's so good. It's so good. And like, I had like those sample Endurance DVDs because Endurance visited different cities. And one of the cities they visited was Buffalo. And they had this whole, like, Discovery Kids visited Buffalo, the zoo. And so Discovery, obviously Endurance, is a part of that. So they had, like, a whole, like, they had the temple.
Yeah.
And, like the whole setup. And they had people compete in different challenges and, like, puzzles. And it was, like, a legit also / audition for the show. And you got to go in, like, the confessional and give, like, an audition. It was, like, the coolest thing I've ever done as a kid.
Were you in like the online community for Endurance at all?
You know, I didn't really discover the online community until Survivor China and beyond, like Survivor Fiji and stuff. So like 2007, So it was around when endurance was about to end, but I was on the online community for the tail end.
Yeah.
So
I was in like the MSN boards or something like that. That was a thing. Like that's a big right? Any if you're an endurance fan, you know, you know. And it's funny because like actually someone in this community, actually his name's Jay. I remember like this is like, I don't even know how, I must have been like 12 or 13 or something. Mm-hmm. Like that. I specifically remembered him because I remember trying hard to get on the show. And again, this is like me in my room, probably like everyone else who was in that group.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
Just like talking with other teens about a show you love. And which is like, maybe that's like questionable in retrospect, thinking of the internet, just talking with strangers.
Yeah,
but they were all weird, like, but they were all trustworthy. It all worked out.
It's the internet. We were like, we're 12. We'll get on the internet and talk about things with people like Survivor and Endurance and such. Mm-hmm. And, you know, seeing these shows and even today, just seeing Jonathan from Endurance Fiji. On season 42,
he was one of my draft picks for this like, season.
Just that alone, I was like, okay, the gates have opened. Can we get some other endurance people in here? Because like,
Who do you want? Who do you want?
There's so many people.
You can name them all.
Okay.
Because I will tell you, speaking of endurance, like John A was on endurance, obviously. I think
she was on the challenge too.
Did she? And she's all over the challenge. She won the challenge All Stars.
Oh my God, John
A.
Last one. She's so good.
She's in the final of this challenge, All Stars too. She would have been the woman winner of Challenge All Stars 1 if they had. If they had a male winner,
winner. God.
So she's so like good. An all-star. You mentioned Jonathan. I feel like I still see on social media, I'll still see like Seely, who was on like season 5 or something like this.
Seely's around. Yep.
Who was like kind of a villain. Yes. Yes.
I could see, Keaton was on the dream team. So that's probably not as possible.
I think I
would
still
would
love
from,
to see
Lily
yep. from season 5, was/is also on the dream team.
Yeah, I was trying to. Yes,
so much overlap.
Yeah, and a lot of overlap. I've podcasted with both of them on here, which is. So
I think cool. I've heard that. So. Yes. Yes,
Monroe and Brianna are still my favorite team of all time. Would love to see either or both of them on Survivor in the future. I think Frank could do a good job. I think Erica would do a really, really good job from Tehachapi on Survivor.
I mean, Sabrina? You would be great on Survivor, but you would have also been great on Endurance.
I know. You know, hey, people could dream maybe one day. You never know.
Maybe you could be on Endurance one day. They'll bring it back as Endurance, and it'll just be like Endurance
for adults. Oh my
yes.
God. Actually, could you imagine Endurance for adults? Because
I mean, I could.
That would be so intense.
That show intense. Was a little bit too dramatic, like and chaotic.
Very dramatic. It was dramatic as kids. Can you even imagine as adults?
I was trying
games
to watch
for picking partners.
Tell me
the drama, like the tea. Like I can't. Oh my goodness.
I'm just saying. Yeah. Look. Yeah. So we've talked a lot about Endurance, but that was one of the shows that led you to kind of where you your reality. Were there any other like big reality TV staples for you? Obviously Survivor is one of them, but
I watched everything.
Yeah.
It really was. Like growing up, I think there was a shift cuz when I was younger, I think when performing arts was like still a dream to be like more of a career. Mm-hmm. I was very much in that. I want to get on American Idol someday and like sing and like make it on TV and like be in Hollywood and get my own record deal. And they're going to, you know,
yes.
And I could lose, but I'll be like, you know, I'll be like Daughtry. I'll be like Jennifer Hudson. I'll be like one of those people that were like, they were the greatest of all time, you know?
Yeah.
These dreams you have as a kid. So you think you can dance? Could not dance for my life, but I could musical theater dance. I couldn't I wanted to learn dance, but it was fascinating watching them do it. But I think I just watched anything and everything that my eyes could look at, like even one-offs. So, you know, Mission Impossible, Expedition Impossible.
Right.
There Goes the Neighborhood, Great American Road Trip, Unanimous, Solitary, Treasure Hunters,
yes.
The Mole, Big Brother, of course, Amazing Race, Kid Nation, which that was,
I wanted to get on that so bad.
That would have been really cool.
I was a little bit too old for that. And obviously they didn't bring it back. Obviously they didn't bring it back for good reasons.
I really wanted to audition for Kid Nation 2. I know being older, I kind of understand why Kid Nation 1 was a one-off that did not come back.
Yes.
But a kid can dream.
No, I love this. And by the way, Aaron, I want to tell you, you're going to Hollywood. You're going to Hollywood. Take your little ticket.
Oh my God.
Oh my gosh. I love this. And I think that the thing that maybe as people are hearing this, I hope there's just a lot of nostalgia being triggered because, like, I know for me, oh my gosh, I don't know why I just got emotional for a second thinking of this, but it was like so lonely kind of watching these different shows at the time because there were shows. Like, I remember when I was watching Flavor of Love and I might have been in like the seventh grade, for example. And again, like, that's one of the shows where it's like, I probably would get yelled at for watching this if my parents
there was
knew.
A lot of VH1 like Flavor of Love,
but people, like, that was a big, like, I remember people in school talking about those shows and being like, you know, making references to it. I'm like, what, there are other people who watch these shows other than me?
But it was kind of on the it was one of those things where it's like you'd go home and watch the shows and then go to school and just not bring it up at all.
Exactly.
Like, maybe in passing, if somebody near you happened to be talking about it. But if you were in different social circles, like, you did, you know, which is weird thinking about now, because now with social media, you can kind of connect with anybody at any time over anything, you know, regardless of if you knew each other or not before you both started watching the show.
Yeah.
Which is kind of cool. You know, it's a way to bring people together now that we didn't really have back then. Or there were a lot of like pro boards and different, you know, message boards that you could go to, but it's not the same. It's not really the same.
I think it's like there's kind of two pieces of that I think are interesting. Like, one is what you're saying is that now we do have more opportunities to connect. But back then, you know, maybe like if you brought up endurance, like maybe no one in your class or whoever or your friends wouldn't have watched it. So they wouldn't know. So it's like, why are you talking about this? Or what are you talking about? This is wild. I'm still watching SpongeBob SquarePants. But then like the other side of it, I feel like is, you know, when you're watching something like even like a Big Brother, and I hear Rob Sesternino of Rob has a podcast, our network's namesake, talking about it, you know, with his kids, especially with Dominic. It's like, Dominic's going into school and talking about Big Brother in school. And it's like, Dominic, no, don't bring up the showmances. Don't do that. Like, and I think that like, there's also that aspect where it's like, sometimes for these shows, it just feels like we're not supposed to talk about it, you know, for whatever reason, whether or not we should be able to. I think we should be able to talk about them anywhere and everywhere. But I do think, I think that kind of is like a smooth little transition into this community. And I don't know if I'm mistaken in this about you, but did you discover, I think I heard that you discovered RHAP around, did you discover it around Nicaragua, Survivor Nicaragua?
Yes.
Okay, what's that story?
Yeah, so I remember being sick during my junior year of high school.
Okay.
And
what year was that for the
2010?
We're really time traveling all over the place in this one. I'm like, help people hold on.
It's really cool for me to remember which grade I was in because.
Yeah.
Whatever the like the end of the academic year, that was always the grade I was in. So at the beginning of 2010, I was in 10th grade. I think so it's very easy for me to like remember all the way down.
Good for you.
I
don't have that benefit. I graduated high school in 2010, so I'm old. Also, I'm sorry I called you old again. I just have to bring that up.
You're younger than you.
Okay. Drag me.
It was my junior year, and I was sick, and it was the moment when the two quits happened in Nicaragua, and I was Nianca just so
Kelly.
I was like, yeah, and I was sick, and I think I happened to like, no, actually, you know what? X it out. I think I discovered more podcasts during that time because I was sick.
Yeah,
and I think I discovered other podcasts. I think I discovered Big Brother 12 that same year, 2010, was when I discovered Rob as a podcast. You don't have to cut anything out here. I was just
No. In my head, I'm like, because I'm Hayden Moss won Big Brother 12. Who else was on that season?
I remember it was like a big, because I remember listening to Rob and Nicole.
The Brigade.
Yeah, Rob and Nicole a lot during that season. And I remember Nicole picking Judd at the beginning of Nicaragua.
Oh, it's like at the beginning Big Brother.
I say Judd at the beginning of Nicaragua because he didn't become Fabio until the premiere. So I remember her picking Judd, and that was like our first Nostradamus moment from her, which was cool. So I think, it was like the summer of 2010. And I just was, discovered podcasts. And then the following summer, I started doing the Freaking Five theme as they did that the following year.
Okay, what is the Freaking Five? Because you mentioned the Freaking Five back in the Black Voices of RHAP 2. And I was like, we'll table that. We'll table that until...
Do you not know what the Freaking Five is?
No, I was not tuned in. I only discovered RHAP in like 2017, I believe.
I'm going to call this the precursor to the Patron Five for Five.
Oh, okay.
So it was a show where Rob and Nicole talked about five things. And I remember at the time during the summer of 2011, there was a lot of Jersey Shore talk.
Yes.
And it was just, it just was out at the time. And
as a Jersey guy, I could attest to the Jersey Shore talk.
It was just I learned a lot through Nicole and Rob.
Yeah.
During the period about the show. But they were, somebody had made a theme for them like a couple weeks in, and I was like, I could make a better theme. I could do it too, And I just submitted my own, and then they used it. I was like, oh, yay. Oh, yeah.
Was that like, so was that your entry point to like, did that lead that was you my, to the
podcast? That was the first time that Aaron Robertson was mentioned on Robert's podcast. Was the summer of 2011 when I released the Freaking Five and the theme, and it was so cool. Yeah.
How old were you? That's the thing that blows my mind, because I'm like
16 Aaron, going on 17.
Oh my God.
Yeah. I still have all the sounds and all the remix versions and things on the computer.
Wow.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's so amazing. And then, one thing I've kind of heard as like a theme for people who, even for people who started in like 2016, 2017, is they were like, it was so much easier to get on the network back then. But what was that process like? Did you just like,
it was just self-made. Them? A lot of it was self-made, just putting myself out there. So anytime after that, I think they still used the sounds for a while. Every time you heard number one, number two, that's me. So even on the five for five, I think they used the numbers a few times. I don't know. And then they brought the Freaking Five back for a special And then, you know, the theme came out. That I was living in the car listening to the theme. It was so fun. It was so nostalgic to me. Yeah, it was really cool. And then I got brought on as a intern person in 2012.
So you were actually an intern in 2012.
Yes, yes. Wow. So yeah, I joined I think correct me if I'm wrong, Allie, but I want to say I was the first person. I was the head of interns at the time when Allie Lasher joined. And I think we had a message all the way back in like, I don't even know, whenever she joined, it was like a really brief combo. That was like our first interaction. And it was like, I didn't even register at the time. I didn't connect that. Oh yeah, this was Allie Lasher that I was talking to. But yeah, it was a long time ago. But yeah, it was really, really neat.
Who else who's like still in, well, wait, I don't want to cut you off. Keep going, please.
Yeah. Who's still in? Well, I know Trey, we were doing a lot of stuff. There's so many. I'd have to go back to the Facebook page and look.
You have to go back to the notebooks Facebook. From back yeah, the in notebooks. The day. Dust yeah, them the off messages. A little bit.
Yes.
It was so long ago. Your notebooks were probably even in black and white.
And then I did a correspondence for Survivor Philippines. Mm-hmm. I chose the Mat Sing tribe preseason.
Yeah.
Which. What a pick that was for me to pick that tribe and get to have to talk with Rob about them their fate during the season.
How many people were on the network at the time? They're like, maybe we could say like, maybe 100 people total are like on Rob as a podcast now with like a core. Yeah, that makes
20 to 25, 30.
Yeah.
We were using Spreecast. I don't know.
How have things like evolved though since that time? And I ask because one thing I love about the community, this even includes me with this, is like, I started listening in 2017. Actually, I started listening, and I always love to mention this to people because I hear similar stories. Like, I started listening right after my dad passed away in 2017 because I saw on social, I think it was like a tweet from Johnny Fairplay, and it was like, oh my God, what's that? I didn't know that he was going to be on a podcast. He was like the one person I followed. And then it was Rob as a podcast. Something or other. And then I just started listening. And then I was listening more and more and more and more. And then everyone became like friends in my head. And then basically, you know, actually, Island of the Idols happened, Survivor 39. And there was everything, lots of conversations about like sexual assault and inappropriate touching, of course, unfortunately.
Yes.
And like part of my background was in that. And I reached out to Rob and I was like, hey, do you need someone to like come on? And he was like, no, we got it figured out. And then like 7 or 8 months later is when the class of 2020 came through. And that's my story. Yeah. And so like, I'm, you know, that's like really recent. Like I've only been on the network 2 years.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, what's the evolution been in your eyes, at least from where you're standing?
It's been weird because it was sort of like, you know, come in with what you can contribute. Mm-hmm. And, you know, being a busy college student at the beginning, I don't really think I treasured the opportunities that I had at the beginning the way I should have. I really do treasure them a lot. I wish I had taken advantage of that period of time more and done more. But it's also like, but you were also a really burnt out, busy college student, which for those... You know, I was a music theater double major. And if you are any double major in the performing arts, you know that like just between the rehearsals for one arts major, like it was always 20 plus hour semesters. So I don't even know.
And
that was when, you know, a lot of my involvement with RHAP started was during that time. I was a freshman when in 2012 when I joined the interns. So it was kind of like, and then like BB Canada was starting, and that was cool to see the evolution of that. And it was, as reality TV became more global and more interconnected, so did the community, and so did the podcast, and so did the people involved. And it was really cool seeing everything develop over time. And it is so cool seeing the way that it is now. And I can't even imagine, like, if 10 years ago you told me that it would be like this now, I would not believe you. And and I'm just thankful for every opportunity that I do have to podcast here, because it's been something that has been a part of my life for, well, in a couple years will be over half my life.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Wow. Well, I'm going to ask you the typical Jeff Probst finale question he used to ask before the finales were immediately after. So Aaron, when people see you in the grocery store, see you on the street, what do they say to you? What is it that they say to you when they recognize you from RHAP on the street? What is it?
Ooh, I think, I don't know.
Is this a thing that happens?
I don't know. Like if I'm ever at an event, think people would know me from like Wanda off in my various appearances, of course.
Do you sign autographs?
I don't think I've ever signed. I don't think anybody's even asked me for an autograph. Like, I feel like there's so many, like, in the hierarchy of people you should ask for an autograph at RHAP, I don't think I'm in like the first 100 people you should ask for an autograph from RHAP or anything related to it. I'm grateful to be here.
Aaron, number one, you're wearing a nice, lovely light blue vest. Could I have your vest, just to borrow from Survivor David versus Goliath there? But also, could I have your autograph? Like, you've never been asked. I need your autograph. Wait, I can't have your autograph. Oh,
yes,
God,
yes,
I just got
yes.
Rejected.
Yes, you can have that. I was saying, no, awkward. I've never been asked.
Sure. Oh my gosh, no! That was dramatic for a second.
No, yes.
Okay, thank you. I'll get it next
time. Nobody's ever asked me before.
Oh my gosh. But I mean, I want to know, like, what has this, you're kind of getting to where I was going with, like, my actual question, which is, like, what this community has meant to you. And you kind of were starting to actually talk about, like, some of the events and meeting people, and you've had the, you know, thankfully I've had the benefit of meeting a good number of listeners over the last year, really. And, you know, I'm curious from you, like, what has it been like meeting people in this community? What has this community meant to you?
Yeah, it's been really cool meeting people in person. I think the greatest thing that was ever said to me was Fishback when I met him in New York. And he was like, oh, I think we've already met. Like, just being somebody that people assume that they have met just because, you know, that's like the best compliment you could ever receive.
I love how that happens and you're like,
you
know,
but
you don't want to break it to them.
Met. It's fine. Yeah.
We met. Yes, Stephen Fishback. I was out there on the island with you.
Yeah. It's been so cool. I actually had a really neat experience of somebody meeting me and talking to me about how they listened to What Does the Llama Say? And we're singing it at a camp, and they were a camp counselor, and them and a kid connected over the song. And I was like, just knowing, like, small moments like that, even if I never hear about it ever, like, it's just really cool. Just knowing that, like, my musical contributions to this podcast, or even just various podcast appearances with my crazy antics and random self, you know, really, brightens people's day and you know, helps them connect and helps them, you know, find joy in the world. And that's what I, you know, going forward, Now that I work remote and have more time on my hands, I would love to contribute more. You know, it's something that I've always wanted to do, but haven't really had the courage to say or speak out about or really request. So I'm just going to put this out into the ether, the universe. I would love to do more podcasts. I don't really care what it is. You know, I love listening to the live feeds every day. Like, I listen to them. I think that, like, because I think more people hear me talk about Survivor than Big Brother, but, like, I listen to those live feed updates so consistently. I have time on my hands. I could watch feeds and talk about that. I don't care what the podcast is. I don't care if it's a random Netflix show. I don't care if it is a one-off topic about things. You know, if you will have me, I will come. I will join. I will, you know, help bring joy to people. So yeah, I'm just gonna put that.
And I love that. And I think that, you know, it kind of transitions into a question that I just want to directly ask in relation to this. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I asked you about like the community overall, but you mentioned like Rob and Nicole and those interactions. Like, could you, I mean, like, what has, I don't know, is there anything that you kind of would like want to say to them if they were here? They are not secretly here. It's not like a Maury situation. Oh, like, come on out, Rob and Nicole. I wish.
I remember between high school and college, in 2012, when I was at a composer's camp in summer, and we don't get mail often, but one of the very few mail pieces I got in 2012 was from Robin Nicole, and that's something that I still have and I still treasure to this day. I've had it for 10 years now, come this summer, and you both have been a very bright light in my life for a long time. I remember hold on, let me get this.
Yeah, you could get it. You could get it. Because like I and it's funny, you're coming back. Come on back.
So when I got into Survivor, it was during 2006.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I got into Guatemala the previous fall. I missed Exile Island.
Yeah.
Because I didn't know it came on in the spring. So while my mom was away in Phoenix, ironically, I got this. This thing I've had for 16 years. This is one of the original Survivor All-Stars DVD sets that was sold at Barnes & Noble. I've had this for 16 years now. I have a second set because this one got scratched because I watched it too much. this guy right here at the bottom.
Yes. Yes.
Has, you know, he.
Rob Cesternino.
Yes. Rob Cesternino has been such a beacon of light for me. You know, I've treasured listening to his commentary on this DVD. Like, I've been listening to Rob's voice for a very long time. And I, you know, when I heard that he had come out with the podcast a few years later, I was very overjoyed. And having the ability to work for you, work alongside you, work with you, podcast with you, meet you, the opportunities that you've given me over the last 11 years is amazing. And the opportunities that I've had to express myself and share memories with us and this, you know, crazy reality TV community that's really into these shows and various mediums. This is something that I'm going to remember for the rest of my life, no matter how long this lasts. Whatever happens in the future, I will be more than happy to continue to work with you and work alongside you, because you have made something really, really cool that has connected so many people together. And in the same way that when I was moving around from place to place to place and having to constantly meet new people and having to readjust, that was something where it was really hard for me to make friends. And with something like this, a place where people are constantly joining and adding and growing in this community, it's constantly meeting new people, but in a good way. And mm-hmm. and in a way that really allowed me to expand my horizons, not just with reality TV, but also introspectively looking at mm-hmm. myself. And I will treasure all of the friendships and relationships that have come out of this.
Wow. And I really felt that. And you know, something that I'll mention here is that, and I don't think I've really talked about this anywhere, but Rob and Nicole were talking about it on the 5 for 5 recently, that I live in Washington, D.C. I drove down to Atlanta for work. I was driving back and stopped in North Carolina, and I was texting Rob, and he's like, come by the house, like come to the house. And I'm like, okay. And I wasn't like, okay. I was like, oh yeah, of course. Like Rob, I'd love to spend time with you. Cause we spend all this time like podcasting together from time to time and everything. And you know, I didn't know like, would the kids be there and would Nicole be there or anything. I stopped at the Rob a couple weeks ago podcasted from a Wegmans. I want to say I stopped at that Wegmans. I was like, you can't show up to someone's house empty handed. So I got like flowers flowers and a bottle of wine for like Nicole or like for whatever. I was just like, Rob, you could like pretend you're giving this to Nicole, or like this is for you to enjoy, like just don't show up empty-handed. And you know, it was I walk in to the house, and of course like Nicole's there, and like the kids are there. And you know, I think the point I'm kind of getting to, one is that other than the fact that they were talking about it on the Patreon 5 for 5, a Patreon, like Patreon only podcast for those who want to check it out, was just like, I feel like the community that you're describing and the ways that you've been touched by the community, even when it was like much smaller, are still elements of the community now. Yeah. And like, they're still bringing that energy. And I think that that is so amazing. And I also, no one asked us to talk about them so at all, but really so like lovingly, but it is really life-changing. And and you know, I could only imagine like 10 plus years of it, how life-changing that can be. But I want to say, like, you know, people who are just getting in now, like you didn't miss it. You know, you're part of it now and the evolution. And now there's like RHAP local, which is this thing that's kind of getting off the ground. And, you know,
I need to do that.
It's all coming together. So you have more opportunities for us to connect. And I love that it's amazing. Like, I love that it's still continuing. And like you said, you couldn't imagine like that it would be what it is today. But like, we're both so thankful that it is what it is today. Right.
Yeah. And, you know, just as there are, you know, rivers that start from different points in the area and meet. We as a community, we may have started from different points, but we all meet in the middle. And in that middle is Rob and Nicole. They've been the heart and soul of this podcast since the very beginning. And I'm very, very thankful for them both. And I'm just really glad that you've been here, and I'm really excited to see, you know, how the community grows in the future.
Oh my gosh, I feel like that was such like a, it feels like it just feels right to kind of get to this point where we're winding down, and like there's so much more that we could touch on.
I know
there's like the fact so that. Many. There's the fact that last September I was like podcasting about you playing a Zoom game of Black Widow Brigade, which was really amazing. I was like, I don't know what Aaron's doing, but I feel like it's interesting because like in having this conversation and you talk about like the random way that you think sometimes, but like it all is so cohesive and artistic and beautiful and unique. And oh my gosh, I feel like I I'm reminding myself of like Nora from season 39 with all some right. of the adjectives. So maybe I don't want to go all the way there. But anyway, you know, shout out. But anyway, you know, I think of that. I think of like, there's just so much there. We were just on the Pride Has Spoken, obviously, with that conversation. And like, there's Black Voices of RHAP, which is another conversation that folks could go. And so there's so much more. There's so much there. But I just want to, number one, thank you, Aaron. And I guess I have like one to two-ish more questions.
Okay.
One question I want to ask, though, and I'm so curious what your answer will be, is a question I ask everybody, which is, if your life were a book or documentary, Aaron, what would the title be of that book or documentary of your life, and why? He's thinking. We hear the thinking. It's happening. This is like a golf a golf game. Golf match? Golf tournament? Golf thing.
The red C, the letter in quotation marks. So the red C.
The red
It's C. It's a play on words. So instead of the red C, it's literally like a red C in quotation marks. The red C. This is a portmanteau created from two things. One is in my synesthesia. C has always been red to me.
Huh.
So,
The letter C has always been red. The letter,
the note C in music has always been red to me.
Right.
So, and it also comes from a quote from my theater teacher when I went to Denison University. Shout out, Denison.
Shout out.
He told me, Aaron, you know, I think I finally get you. A lot of people would say A, B, C. You would say A is a letter, C.
Wow.
Hence the red C, because C is red to me, but also connecting that logic of the way that I think. And the way that I express myself, I really think has always been perfected with that quote that's been said to me by my theater teacher.
I will say, Aaron, and this is all meant to be, that I'm going to have to go back, listen to that, and process that and figure out what that means. A is the letter C.
So, like, you know how people would say, okay, I'll let you explain. Yeah, you know how people would say, like, you know, people would communicate, like, saying A, B, C, D, E, like, your ideas in a straight order.
Yeah.
I would say something like, in terms of connecting logic, I would say A is a letter.
Yes.
C. And, like, that's just the logic, because my logic, I've already jumped to C. And I would explain things in a different way, but the logic is still there. The way that I express it is different. Like, can you imagine me on Goose Goose Duck playing with you all?
Because that's the thing. I can, and it all makes sense. And I think it's good that you explain that, but also. It also would have been great if you didn't, because I think that would totally speak to your point about connect in your brain and everything. Yeah. And sometimes it just takes a little bit more time for people to connect those dots. Like, you need to take a step back and listen. And I think that that's one thing that's so important, is like, we don't all think the same and we don't all see the world the same way. Like, the colors that we see, we sometimes think we see the thing, we sometimes think we hear and see and feel and experience things the same way, and that is just not the case. Like, the world is so different for all of us, and I realized this like earlier this year, where I was like, oh my gosh, I've talked about this before in other places, but I had LASIK eye surgery, but before that I had like contacts. And one day, you know, you're not allowed to wear contacts before. You have to wear, like, glasses for 2 weeks before. And I took off my glasses, and I was just like, damn, I can't take a picture of this. There's no way that anyone's ever going to be able to see what this really horrible eyesight looks like. No one's going to know exactly what I see when I look out at the world without, you know, even now people don't know. And I think there's something kind of deep about that. And it's cool that you bring such a unique lens to it.
Yeah. Oh, I just thought of a full title for it. So it would be, and I'll write this out so that you can write it out for future things.
Okay.
But if, you know, it would be called The Red Sea,
colon.
Oranges. Decomposing. Arranging.
Mm-hmm. Arranging. What? The Red Sea, colon, oranges, decomposing, arranging?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah, man. See, the way I wrote it out there, yeah.
We're not even, I mean, that's what
there's
I thought.
So many different little hidden messages in there as well.
Aaron.
I'm actually going to write a book called The Red Sea, Oranges, Decomposing, Arranging, and like write it out. And then I will show it to you. And
let me just do one of these, because you did something so impressive just now. You went like about 5 minutes ago, you put a bow on it. You were like, life, it's just the way it is. It was like whatever you said, it was deep. And then you just went, bam, I'm going to hit with the Aaron.
Yes.
And that's what we love. And I'm thankful for it. And, you know, I just want to give you the floor. Any final words for, well, not final words. You will have many more words to come. But final words for this podcast that you want to share with people, or anything you want to say or put out into the world for the community that's listening, the pod friends that are listening.
Yeah. As we head into the second half of 2022, you know, I think there's so much potential for a lot of different things to happen in the world at this point. And, I'm grateful for you all as a community. I'm grateful to be a part of it. And, just as the book title of my book suggests, I hope that, you know, we can put a nice coda to the year. And
damn it, Aaron.
So see, orange is decomposing, arranging. The first letters of that spell out coda, and the red coda is a beautiful sunset. And I feel like life is about making beautiful sunsets, and I really want to you know, both in the way that when you look at a sunset, you reflect on life. I want the book to not only be a reflection of me as a person, but also give opportunities for others to do that as well. And I feel like I hope that, you know, when we look at the sunset that is 2022 and we go to that final coda at the end of the year, that, you know, the second half of the year, we can develop it into a beautiful sunset and something that, you know, we'll look back on and remember fondly.
Thank you so much, everyone, for tuning into this week's episode of Pod Friends with Aaron. Isn't he incredible? There's just so much there and so many twists and turns and laughs. And if anything, I think what's really beautiful is that I'm getting choked up again, actually, thinking about some of what Aaron was saying, just about being thankful for the journey as it continues on. But, you know, I love that Aaron's story, and, you know, even though he's someone who acknowledges thinking differently and connecting ideas differently, like, it resonated so much with me along the way, and I hope that that was the case for all of you. And yet, he's his own unique self. And I love that for him. And I love that for each of us, that we each bring our uniqueness to this community. And each of us pod friends is different and unique and brings something different. So I hope that you'll subscribe to Pod Friends. If you're not already subscribed, drophiswebsite.com/podfriendsfeed. I also just want to plug some other stuff that's been going on. You can check me out on the Wrestling Rehab Up. With the one and only Mari Forth talking about pro wrestling. We provide a playlist of clips in the show notes so that you don't even have to watch wrestling that week or at all. You just need to watch the short playlist of clips, like an hour of clips. You can watch on 2x speed if you want. It becomes a half hour of clips. And basically, like, it's a great way to keep up with wrestling. So you can check that out at robhiswebsite.com/wrestlingfeed. If you want to check out The Pride Has Spoken, which was the incredible podcast that I just wrapped up with Dr. Evie Jagoda and Grace Leader, who was recently on Pod Friends, it was all about Survivor, all about queer representation. And over the course of June, it's kind of hard to believe that we had 20 survivors as part of the series, 20 queer survivor players as part of the series, which, like, I think it's even mind-blowing that we've had that many, but that shows how far we've really come over time, especially in the last 5 years, thinking of how many of them came from that time. But we also had survivors going way back. And so I'm excited for you to check that out. You can check it out at robhaswebsite.com/pridefeed. And there's the Pride Has Spoken t-shirt, which you could still get, and proceeds will go to a phenomenal trans-led organization supporting trans and gender non-conforming people in the southern U.S. who could really use the support. And so check that out. Again, robhaswebsite.com/pridefeed, where we talk a lot about that. But thank you so much, everyone, for being on the journey. And I'm excited to hear from you, to hear your feedback. Tweet me again at @MattScottGW. Tweet me at @HeyPodFriends, and we'll be in touch. But as always, I just want to thank you. I want to genuinely say I appreciate you being here and listening. I know that you don't have to. I know if you're hearing the sound of my voice now, you know, not everyone stays to the end. Not everyone listens to every episode. And so it does genuinely mean a lot to me that you're here. And I actually just want to say, like, show you so much love. And as I say at the end of each of these episodes, as always, and I mean it from the bottom of my heart, thank you for being a pod friend.